मालूम खेळांना भारतातल्या अनेक मोठ्या खेळाडूंना आणि कलाकारांना ज्यांनी उत्तमाचा ध्यास लावला त्या बामसरांच्या स्मृतिप्रीत्यर्थ आपण हा उपक्रम सुरू केलेला आहे. उत्तमाच्या ध्यासामध्ये ज्या अनेक उपासना आणि प्राणायाम आवश्यक आहेत ते आम्हाला रामसरांनी शिकवले, तर तोच सरांनी दिलेला वारसा पुढे नेण्याचा विचार ह्याच्या मागे आहे. आणि तो वारसा नेण्यास जे समृद्ध आहेत असे सरांचे शिष्य संदीपजी जाधव आपल्या बरोबर सत्र घेत आहेत. हे सत्र तिसरं आजचं आहे आणि त्यासाठी आलेल्या तुम्ही सर्वांचं मी मला स्वागत करते आणि परिचय करून देण्यासाठी संदीपजींचा मी प्रशांतजींकडे ही सूत्र सुपूर्द करते.
मी प्रशांत घाणेकर, बामपंथीयांमधले सगळे संदीपजींना ओळखतातच, तरी जे नव्याने जॉईन झालेले आहेत त्यांच्यासाठी ओळख करून देतो. संदीप जाधव हे सध्या प्रज्ञा इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ योगा कझाकिस्तानचे डायरेक्टर आहेत. त्यांनी हे योगासाठीचे नवीन गुरुकुल चालू केले, ज्या योगे इंडियन ट्रॅडिशनल योगा याचा प्रसार होऊ शकेल. संदीप यांनी आपला योगाचा अभ्यास 1999 पासून अभ्यास सुरू केला. योग विद्या गुरुकुल येथे श्री विश्वास मंडलिक यांच्या मार्गदर्शनाखाली त्यांनी तो चालू केला. 2001 ते 2007 मध्ये या संस्थेमध्ये ते शिकवत होते व अजूनही या संस्थेशी कनेक्टेड आहेत आणि अल्मट्टी कझाकिस्तान येथे त्यांनी त्यांचे कोर्सेस घेतात. संदीपजी श्री विश्वराज बाम सरांबरोबर त्यांनी अनेक योगाची वेगवेगळी तंत्र शिकून घेतली आणि अजूनही त्यांचा योगाभ्यास चालू आहे. सध्या ते नागपूरच्या कवी कालिदास इन्स्टिट्यूट मधून मास्टर्स डिग्री घेत आहेत. गेली 2 वर्ष आम्ही त्यांचे भारतात हे योगाची शिबिरं घेत होतो, पण आज ऑनलाईनच्या माध्यमांमुळे आज कझाकिस्तान मधनं हे तिसरं शिबिर ते आपल्यासाठी घेत आहेत. त्यासाठी मी संदीपजींना सांगतो की त्यांनी पुढे सूत्र.
धन्यवाद वंदनाताई, धन्यवाद प्रशांतजी आणि धन्यवाद पौर्णिमाताई हा पूर्ण कार्यक्रम आयोजित केल्याबद्दल. आणि मला आमचा बामपंथी ग्रुप यांना सुद्धा धन्यवाद द्यावेसे वाटेल, कारण त्यांच्या आशीर्वादाने, त्यांच्या सहवासाने आणि त्यांच्या मार्गदर्शनाने या सर्व गोष्टी शक्य होऊ शकतात. आज पुन्हा एकदा संधी साधून आली की आपल्याला तिसऱ्यांदा एकत्र भेटता येते आणि खरं म्हणजे कोरोना व्हायरस त्यामुळे सगळेच जण त्रस्त झाले, पण त्याचा चांगला भाग बघितला तर ऑनलाईन क्लासेस सुरू झालेत आणि यामुळे आपल्याला एकमेकांशी सहजपणे भेटता येतात. तर नेहमीप्रमाणे आज आपण पुन्हा एकदा त्रिवार ओंकार म्हणायचा आणि शांती मंत्र. बाम सर नेहमी सांगायचे की ज्यावेळेस कोणती साधना सुरू करतात त्यावेळेस हा शांती मंत्र म्हणून आपल्याला साधना सुरू करायची. आज पुन्हा एकदा मी त्रिवार ओंकार म्हणतो आणि त्यानंतर शांती मंत्र म्हणणार आहे. तर आपल्याला जर माहित असेल हा शांती मंत्र ओम सहना भवतु, तो सुद्धा माझ्यासोबत म्हणायचा. आता यापुढे मी इंग्रजीमध्ये बोलणार आहे जेणेकरून जे मराठी भाषिक नाहीये त्यांना सुद्धा सहजपणे समजू शकेल. सो नाव आय एम गोइंग टू स्पीक इन इंग्लिश सो दॅट दोज पीपल हु डोंट अंडरस्टँड ऑल मराठी लँग्वेज विल बी इझी फॉर देम to understand the whole seminar, the whole session. So I request all of you please be seated in any comfortable meditative position. If it is difficult for you to sit on the floor, sit on your yoga mat with cross leg position. You can even sit on the chair or on the sofa, but make sure your back remains straight. Your back should be straight. Don't hunch your back, don't hunch your shoulders, back straight. Place your hands on your knees in Dhyan Mudra, or you can say Dhyan Mudra. Tip of thumb and index finger should be kept together, remaining 3 fingers together, but they should be relaxed. Place your hands on your knees, keep your back straight, neck straight. Close your eyes, close your eyes. Take a deep breathe in, breathe out, Again, take a deep breath in. Breathe out. Now breathe smoothly. We will start this session by chanting mantra Om 3 times all together, followed by Shanti mantra. So get ready for Om. Breathe in. Thank you so much once again for giving me this opportunity to share whatever information I have, whatever knowledge I have regarding pranayama. But last time, if you remember, those who joined our last session, the previous session, in which we studied Kapalabhati, then also we practiced Nadi Shuddhi and Brahmari Pranayama. So at the end of the session, I said that I'll be happy to have the next session if you promise me that whatever practices we have done till now, you will be practicing them by yourself at home. So I consider, I hope that all of you have done all those practices which we have been practicing since last couple of months. So just as a revision, what we have studied in our first session. So we have started this. This is our third session. What we have studied in our first session, it was Amrut Pranayama. One of the very strong, one of the very great, one of the very beautiful pranayama, which is taught to us by Bhamsar, Vishnuraj Bhamsar. So that was a beautiful pranayama which we have studied in our first session. Also, we have studied some other techniques like Nyas and some other techniques. In the second session, we studied Kapala Bhati, also Nadi Shuddhi pranayama, and one more pranayama, that is Brahmari pranayama, humming bee sound. So today we are going to study some more pranayama. After our last session, some people, they wrote me personally, and then many of them, they asked me that it is still difficult for many of them to use their abdominal muscles and diaphragm while practicing breathing. So today I have decided I will give more focus on very simple exercise, very simple practice, that is deep breathing. And while practicing deep breathing, we will study how to use the abdominal area, how to use our diaphragm, and how to use the thoracic area while practicing deep breathing. It's a very simple practice. It's not actually very difficult. But what happens as we grow old, our breathing pattern, you know, it gets disturbed because of our lifestyle. If you look at the children, small children, like small babies, and if you see how they are breathing, we can immediately see that whenever they breathe or whenever they are lying down, they breathe with the abdomen. You can see the movements of their abdomen, you know. When they inhale, their abdomen moves up. When they exhale, it goes down. And it happens so easily, it happens so smoothly, naturally, that these small babies, they are not like making any kind of effort. So it's a very natural process. And If you study a little bit of anatomy, physiology of the human body, we will understand that whenever we breathe in, our chest, okay, this cage, rib cage expands, our diaphragm just goes down just to have big space in the lungs. And whenever we breathe out, again our diaphragm comes back to the normal position, our rib cage again comes back, so our diaphragm comes back up. So this is very normal, like basic things about how our diaphragm moves at the time of breathing. So same kind of technique or same way we are going to breathe in a deep breathing. So if you look at the babies, as I already said, that they are moving their abdomen smoothly, naturally. So in the process of deep breathing today, we are going to have the same thing. Just I will explain deep breathing in a little bit more detail so that it will be easy for you to follow the deep breathing. So before we start practicing deep breathing, again, I would like to remind all of you, like those people who were there in the last session or in the first session, they already know about this thing. But those people who join us today for the first time, again, I would like to remind you that whenever you want to practice pranayama, any kind of pranayama, any kind of breathing exercises, it is very much recommended to start with some warm-up exercises. Whatever warm-up exercises you know, it can be basic movements, like basic movements for every joints, neck movements, shoulder movements, elbow movements, wrist joints, for your spine, for your hips, for your knees, for your ankle joints. And then after practicing those warm-up exercises, you must practice Shavasana, because Shavasana will help you to stabilize your breathing rate. And after Shavasana, then you can go for Pranayama practice. If some people, they are already advanced in yogic practices, then they can even practice Surya Namaskar. Surya Namaskar is the best exercise to should be practiced before Pranayama. So you can even practice Surya Namaskar. If you don't know how to practice Surya Namaskar, I can share the video with you and you can just follow the videos with all the instructions there. So you just need to follow all the instructions how to practice Surya Namaskar, technically that. So it is very much recommended to practice some warm-up exercises, some preparatory movements, Surya Namaskar or some other exercises. There are some good set of exercises. It is called a Sukshma Vyayam. Sukshma Vyayam is also a very beautiful set of exercises which mobilizes even subtle joints in our body. So now, of course, we are not going to practice some warm-up exercises because we have very limited time. We have only 1.5 hours for this session. And if we spend some time for warm-up exercises, we will not have enough time to study all those pranayama, all those techniques which we supposed to study today. So today, of course, if you have done your warm-up exercises in the morning, Surya Namaskar, good. If you haven't done it, next time whenever you will practice pranayama, I strongly recommend all of you to practice those exercises, to practice Surya Namaskar and then practice Shavasana. Shavasana is must. So don't forget about Shavasana. Shavasana is not only lying down and sleeping, but Shavasana is consciously focusing on each and every part of your body and relaxing each and every part of your body, each and every muscle of your body. So in very short time, in a very short time span, you can relax your body completely. Shavasana is the must after practicing warm-up exercises. So please don't do these mistakes, because I have seen some people that they practice Surya Namaskar or warm-up exercises and they say that, oh, I'm not tired, so I can just go with my next practices. So it is not about you're tired, you're physically too much tired or not, but when you practice such kind of intensive practices, your breathing rate is not normal. It is not stabilized yet. So your breathing rate is a little bit higher than normal. So Shavasana will help you to stabilize your breathing rate and then you can go for your pranayama practice. So we have already practiced some basic techniques. That is Kapalabhati. Kapalabhati, it is, as I said last time, it is a cleansing technique. It is also called as Shuddhi Kriya or Shat Karma. There are 6 different cleansing techniques: Dhauti, Basti, Neti, Tratak, Nauli, and Kapalabhati. So Kapalabhati is one of the very good cleansing technique for the lungs. Also, it is very beautiful technique for your nervous system. Kapalbhati is also very good exercise for all internal organs, especially organs in the abdominal region, which massages all those organs. So those people who have any issues with the digestive organs or liver or pancreas gland, it is very good for them. Even those people who are suffering with constipation, Kapalbhati is one of the very good remedy for them. So I'm just first explaining you the whole flow, how it should be done, and then we will go for actual practices. So first you have started with your warm-up exercises. Of course, it is recommended to chant mantra Om and prayers, Shanti mantra, which we have chanted today. Or if you know some other prayers, other mantras, you can chant those prayers. After that, you can practice warm-up exercises or Surya Namaskar. Of course, Surya Namaskar is not only warm-up exercise. It has even more dimensions to it. It is physical practice. Even pranayama is included in Surya Namaskar. And also, some meditation practices are also included in Surya Namaskar. You need to focus on different chakras while practicing Surya Namaskar. But you can practice Surya Namaskar just as a physical exercise, just for warm up. After Surya Namaskar or after physical exercises, you must practice Shavasana. Shavasana is the most important. Minimum 3 to 5 minutes of Shavasana you should practice. Make sure you don't sleep in Shavasana. Many people, like when they are tired or they don't sleep good enough in the night, and then whenever they practice Shavasana, they just go to sleep. So it's better not to sleep in Shavasana. Just spend 3 to 5 minutes for Shavasana, and after finishing Shavasana, then you can practice first cleansing, lungs cleansing, that is Kapalbhati. Kapalbhati, you can practice around 3 to 5 rounds of Kapalbhati. Last time we practiced few rounds of Kapalbhati, and I said like the ideal speed of Kapalbhati should be 120 rounds per minute. If you can reach this ideal speed, very good. If you can't reach it, you can practice Kapalbhati with whatever speed is comfortable for you. Okay. Now, those people who don't know how to practice Kapalbhati, then they can watch our previous video, that is the second video. In second video, I have explained Kapalbhati in more details, so it will help you to understand how to practice Kapalbhati. After practicing Kapalbhati, minimum 3 to 5 rounds of Kapalbhati. If possible, you can practice Kapalbhati for 3 to 5 minutes at a stretch without any break. But if it is difficult for you, then you can practice one round for 1 minute, then take small break for 30 seconds, again go for second round, again small break, and again third round. After practicing Kapalbhati, if you feel fine, strong, not tired, then you can immediately continue pranayama practice. But after Kapalbhati, if you feel a little bit tired or a little bit dizzy, it is very much recommended again to practice Shavasana. So after Kapalbhati, if you feel tired, better to practice Shavasana. But after Kapalbhati, if you feel good enough, if you feel strong enough, then even without Shavasana, you can go for next pranayama. The next, the very important pranayama, Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama. If you remember last time we were discussing that Hatha Yoga has mentioned 8 important pranayama, and those pranayama are called as Ashta Kumbhak. If you divide or if you categorize those 8 pranayama, we will understand that there are 4 categories of those 8 pranayama. Okay. 4 categories of those 8 pranayama. The first category, you can say it's a hitting pranayama, means those pranayama which creates heat in our body. 2 pranayama are there, that is Surya Bhedan pranayama and Bhastrika pranayama. The second category, that is cooling pranayama, that is Shitali pranayama and Sitkari pranayama. Then there are 2 more pranayama which is also considered as pre-meditative pranayama, or you can say which helps you to develop your meditation practice, or which helps you as a foundation for meditation practice, that is Brahmari pranayama and Ujjayi pranayama. Last time we have studied Brahmari pranayama, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू फोकस ऑन उज्जायी प्राणायाम, वेरी सिंपल बट वेरी वेरी इफेक्टिव प्रैक्टिस. एंड देयर इज वन मोर कैटेगरी, इट इज कॉल्ड एज ट्रांस प्राणायाम और पोस्ट मेडिटेटिव प्राणायाम. दिस इज वेरी एडवांस प्रैक्टिस. It should be done only when you are master with previous pranayama. That is murcha pranayama. Murcha, it means unconscious state, or even the state, you know, by which you reach at this higher state of meditation. So that's why it is called as trance pranayama. There is one more, plagini pranayama, in which actually you inhale, you hold your breath, and you can either float on the water or you can even stay under water. It's a very advanced pranayama. Murcha pranayama I have experienced myself. Plavini I never tried in my life, because my guru said that first of all you have to be very strong enough for plavini pranayama. But of course previous pranayama, whatever I have said, these are very useful. So today we are going to focus on ujjayi pranayama. So these are the eight pranayama. Nadi shuddhi is not mentioned in those eight pranayama. Nadi shuddhi pranayama, it is actually considered as the preparation for those eight pranayama. And that's why whenever you will finish your kapalbhati practice, as I said, like first warm up exercises, then shavasana, then kapalbhati, then after kapalbhati you must practice nadi shuddhi pranayama, because this is the preparation for remaining pranayama. The effect of nadi shuddhi is it's given in its name itself, nadi shuddhi, because the purpose of nadi shuddhi is to clean all the psychic passages, all the energy channels in our body. It helps to clean the nadis from our bodies. And then when you will practice all these exercises, then you can go for whatever pranayama you have decided. It can be either bhramari or ujjayi or surya bhedan or bhastrika or shitali or sutra. Okay, so today we are going to focus on ujjayi pranayama. And as I said at the beginning, that today we are going to again focus on very simple deep breathing. And today I want to show you how to use the abdominal area and the thoracic area for deep breathing. This is very, very important. What happens, as I said, that small babies, you know, naturally they breathe like this. But as we grow old, as our lifestyle changes, our breathing pattern changes. Have you seen people when they are angry, how they breathe? You know, when they are angry, they are very intense breathing. We haven't seen people, you know, who are very much angry and breathing very smooth. It is very difficult because our emotions are very much connected with our breathing. So whenever people are angry or any stressful emotion, their breathing is very intense. But whenever people are relaxed, you know, whenever people are calm, quiet, they breathe very smoothly, calmly, quietly. And especially those people who are relaxed, they breathe with the abdomen. You know, it was my habit. Once I was talking with Bamsar long back, and then Bamsar was actually mentioning these aspects of our emotions and breathing, how they're interlinked with each other. And he was sitting on his chair and he was talking to me and some other students were there, and he was saying that how our emotions are connected with the breathing. And then he said, those people who are very much relaxed, how they breathe, you know, usually they breathe with the abdomen. If you look at their abdomen, if you observe the abdomen moves, you know, in and out, in and out. And then from that point on, it became my habit to observe Bamsar's belly. Of course, it's not good to say, but then it just became my habit to observe how Bamsar, how my guru is breathing. You know, if he's talking about breathing, if he's talking that emotions are connected with our breathing, and breathing is more important, you know, to control your emotions. He always said that it is not like that, no yogis, they will never have stress in their life. Like everybody has stress in their life. Normal people, even great yogis, they have stress in their life. But what is the difference between normal people and yogis? That yogis, they have the ability to get out of the stress very quickly. So if you observe the breathing of yogis, great yogis, you will see how they breathe by using their bellies. And then whenever I was watching Bamsar, I was, you know, observing his abdominal movements, how he is breathing. And I was actually very happy that I got such kind of guru in my life. I never ever saw him, you know, breathing without abdominal movements. Whenever I was watching him, like whenever he was watching television or talking with the people or simply sitting or reading newspaper or doing whatever, and whenever I got chance to observe him, I always watch how he was breathing with his abdomen. Anyway, so again coming back to our point, how to breathe by using the abdominal area and the thoracic area. So this is actually very simple. There is one concept called as yogic breathing, in which you use three areas: abdominal area, thoracic area, and the clavicular area or collarbones till this point. Okay, but that third point is a bit difficult for many people, so that's why today we are not going to focus on the clavicular part. Today we are not going to focus on the third area. Today we will be focusing only on two areas: abdominal area and the thoracic area. Now listen carefully. It's a very simple process. Our inhalation and exhalation should be done through the nose. Listen, inhalation and exhalation should be done through the nose. So what we are doing, we are breathing in deeply and smoothly through the nose, and we are breathing out smoothly and long again through the nose. So we are not using our mouth now. Like for Amruta Pranayama, we have studied breathing out through the mouth, but here we are not going to breathe out through the mouth. We will be breathing only through the nose. So inhalation and exhalation will happen only through the nose. Now, next very important part, okay? So the first important part, inhalation, exhalation through the nose. Second important part, now just imagine the graph of your breath. Okay, in your mind, just make a picture of how you are breathing. Okay? For example, if I ask you to breathe in deeply, how it will go? Smooth curve, you know, exponential curve up, and breathe out, smooth curve down, you know. It will look like a mountain. So if you look at my finger, how I'm moving my finger, you know, smooth inhalation up, smooth exhalation down. So it will look like kind of mountain shape, you know. So just keep this picture in your mind so that it will be easy for you to understand this type of breathing. Actually, it's very easy, but just to understand in more details. So now let's divide this mountain in two halves. So the upper part and the lower part. Okay, again I am repeating. Divide this mountain or divide this graph of the breath in two halves. Okay, upper part and the lower part. It means inhalation will be divided in two parts, first half, second half. And the exhalation will be divided in two halves, first half and second half. Okay, so first half of inhalation, then second half of inhalation, first half of exhalation, and then second half of exhalation. And now let's understand how to use abdominal area and when to use, and how and when to use thoracic area. Listen carefully. In the first half of inhalation, we will be using abdominal area. In the second half of inhalation, we will be using thoracic area. Then when you will start exhalation, in the first half of exhalation, we will be using thoracic area. And in the second half of exhalation, we will be using abdominal area. But how to use it? Now again listen. In the first half of inhalation, as I said, that we are going to use the abdominal area. I will demonstrate it. Okay. So in the first half of exhalation, as I said, we are going to use the abdominal area. It means you're slightly relaxing the abdominal area. So your abdomen goes slightly out, or you can say it expands, but don't forcefully expand it. Okay. Some people, when they inhale, they try to expand their abdomen forcefully. Please don't do that. Okay. Just relax your abdomen and you will see that as soon as you relax your abdomen just opens up. It just expands gently, okay, gently. So this should be done in the first half, in half of inhalation. So first half of inhalation, your abdomen expands. Then second half of inhalation, your chest should expand maximum. Okay. Then exhalation. First half of exhalation, your chest comes back. In the second half of exhalation, your abdomen comes back and give slight pull to your abdomen inwards. Okay. Again, I'm repeating. And after this explanation, I'm going to demonstrate how to use these parts. But even if I'm telling you that first half, second half, again, first half, second half, doesn't mean that there should be break. Okay. There should not be any pause. There should not be any break. There should not be any kind of retention of the breath. It should be done smoothly, starting from the first point till the last point for inhalation. Same way, exhalation, starting from the first point till the last point. So only for understanding, I have divided this graph in two parts. So again, I'm saying first half of inhalation using the abdominal area, expand it slightly without any efforts. Second half of inhalation, expand the chest. Okay. Then here you can actually make efforts and expand the chest as much as you can. Then first half of exhalation, relax the chest. And the second half of exhalation, move your abdomen inwards. You can give slight pull inwards. Okay. Now I'm going to show you. If possible, you can sit in Padmasana. Otherwise, you can even simply sit in cross-leg position. Now, I don't want anybody to practice. Now it is just time to watch. Okay. Demonstration only. Don't practice it. Okay. Some people, they have habit like when they are watching demonstration, they start practicing. But I request you, when you are watching demonstration, better not to practice, because you know when you start practicing at the time of demonstration, you keep your brain busy. You're watching at the same time you're doing it. So brain is, you know, busy for two activities. So it's difficult for the brain to focus on demonstration completely. So I want all of you to watch, only watch. Now look at me. I'm going to use the abdominal area for inhalation first and then thoracic area, and then for exhalation first thoracic area and then the abdominal area. Okay, watch. Of course, I am going to show you in halves, in small parts, but with breaks. But when you practice, it should be done without breaks. So watch. First abdominal area. So when you will start inhalation, you have to kind of expand abdominal area like this. So this is the first half of inhalation. Okay. Then the second half of inhalation, I'm going to expand the chest. So again, I'm showing you abdomen and chest. I'm expanding the chest. In the first half of exhalation, now I'm relaxing my chest. And in the second half of exhalation, I'm pulling my abdomen inwards. Okay. Again, breathing in, that is inhalation, first abdomen, then chest, then exhalation, first chest, then abdomen. Again, now I'm not going to give you any instructions. I hope you have understood these two areas. Just watch. So now for demonstration purpose, I have shown you with breaks. For the practice, don't do any breaks. Now I'm going to show you without any breaks. Just watch. I hope you have understood how to use the abdominal area and the thoracic area. while practicing deep breathing. Okay. Now I want all of you to experience this. Okay. So now I'm going to give you instructions. We will be spending next 3 to 4 minutes for this kind of breathing. Okay. First few rounds, I will be giving you instructions to focus on different areas. And then I will give you some time to follow the practice by yourself. Okay. I hope it will be easy for you to follow the instructions. So I request all of you, please be seated with cross-leg position. If possible, Padmasana. If not, simply cross-leg, Sahasrasana, Swastikasana, whatever meditative positions you know. Even you can even sit in Vajrasana, if you know Vajrasana. But if it is difficult for you to sit with cross-leg position because of your knees or because of some other issues, you can simply sit on the chair. But make sure don't sit on the sofa. Sofa is very soft, and when you practice deep breathing, you know, it moves. So it doesn't give a very good practice. So surface should be very hard. It can be chair with hard surface. If your sofa is very hard surface, that is also good. Get ready, back straight, neck straight. Now place your hands in Jnana Mudra. Keep your thumb, index finger together. Remaining 3 fingers together. Place them on your knee. Back straight, neck straight. And now close your eyes. Now close your eyes. Close your eyes. Breathe normally. Breathe smoothly. Please don't start the practice yet. You will start with my instructions. Just follow my instructions. Please close your eyes. Make sure your body is relaxed completely. Relax your neck. Relax your shoulders. Relax your arms. Relax your back, your legs. Make sure your back is straight. Now focus on your breath. Don't control the rhythm of your breath. Just simply focus on your breath. Simply focus on your breath. Breathe smoothly, naturally, without any control, without any force. Now we are going to practice deep breathing, simple deep breathing, by using the abdominal area and the thoracic area. Now we are going to practice deep breathing with the abdominal and the thoracic area. As I already said and showed, first half of inhalation, you're expanding your abdomen, second half of inhalation, chest, then first half of exhalation, you're relaxing your chest, and second half of exhalation, you're pulling your abdomen slightly in. So get ready. First of all, breathe out completely through your mouth. Now close your mouth, and now you can start. Breathe in, abdomen, chest. Breathe out, chest, abdomen. Breathe in, abdomen, chest. Breathe out, chest, abdomen. Very good, Agashiji. Breathe in, abdomen, chest. Breathe out, chest, abdomen. Now continue the practice for next 3 minutes. Please continue the practice for next 3 minutes. Keep your eyes closed. Now I'm not going to give you instructions. I will be just correcting your posture. I will not give you instructions for breathing. You follow your own rhythm. You follow your own rhythm for inhalation and for exhalation. But make sure your inhalation should be deep. And exhalation should be deep and long. Don't do quick inhalation, quick exhalation. It should be deep and long inhalation and deep and long exhalation. Very good. Don't bend your back. Make sure your back remains straight, neck straight, eyes closed. Mentally observe the movements of your abdomen and the movements of your chest. Feel the expansion in the abdomen and in the chest at the time of inhalation. And observe how your chest and abdomen is moving back to normal position at the time of exhalation. Very good. Two more minutes. Two more minutes. Continue the practice. Don't stop. If you feel tired, take small break for 5-10 seconds. Again, continue the practice. One and a half minute to go. Good. Continue the practice. One more minute. Make sure your back is straight, neck straight. Last two rounds. And after completing last two rounds, breathe normally. Very good. Close your eyes. Please do not open. Close your eyes. Just close your eyes and observe the state of your mind. It gives a very peaceful state of the mind. When you practice deep breathing like this, by using your abdomen, it gives a very peaceful state of the mind. As I said, our emotions are connected with our breathing. So usually whenever people are having stressful emotions, they breathe very short and intensively. And whenever people are relaxed, then they breathe long and with abdomen. Vice versa, if you develop the habit to breathe with the abdomen, you will develop peaceful emotions, peaceful state of the mind. Now I request all of you to open your eyes. I request all of you to open your eyes and sit comfortably. I hope you have understood this technique. It's actually a very simple technique, as I said, that it really develops very peaceful state of the mind. Once I was sitting with Bouncer and he was telling me, Sandeep, today I will tell you the story of water in the glass. I said, yeah, I know the story, you know, half glass of water, how you look at the glass. Some people, they say it's half empty, some people say it's half full. This story, right? Bouncer said, no, not this story. So it's a different story. So he said, like, just imagine that there is only 10 milliliter of water in one glass. Simple, one more normal glass. And if I ask you to hold this glass in your hand, you know, just for 5 seconds, very little bit of water, the glass is almost empty, little bit of water. And if I ask you to hold the glass for 5 seconds. So is it possible for you? He said, of course, like it's easy possible. No, it's not difficult. Just there's no water. It's not heavy at all. It's only one glass and then you're holding for 5 seconds. And then he said, if I ask you to hold it for 1 hour, and I said, like, oh, I'm strong enough. I can still hold for 1 hour. But of course, my hands will get tired. And then he said, if I ask you to hold it for one day, I said, then it's a tough job. You know, you really need like a very strong mind and strong body to hold it for one day. And then he was saying like, it is actually, we were talking about Patanjali Yoga Sutras. And then he was giving this example of the stress. And then he said like, it is same like stress, that actually, whenever people say that we have a lot of stress in our life, and if you really analyze yourself, actually stress starts from very minute things, from very, very small things. But it depends like how long you hold the stress. If you hold the stress for 5 seconds, then it doesn't create too much, you know, pain in your life. But if you hold the stress for 1 hour, it's going to create a bit stress. If it's going to be for one day, if you're going to hold your stress for one day or for 1 month or for 1 year, it's going to paralyze you. Or you can end up. So he was actually talking about different vrittis in Patanjali Yoga Sutras. If you have gone through Patanjali Yoga Sutras, he was talking about different vrittis, and then he was giving this example of stress. So same way, he said, how long you hold the stress, it's going to, you know, reflect your life. In our lifestyle, somehow we develop the habit to hold the stress for long, to hold the grudges for long, you know, to hold the jealousy for long, and then it's going to create a lot of pain to you. So this technique, why I'm talking about this experience of mine with Bansar, because this technique, whatever we have done now, deep breathing by using the abdominal area and the thoracic area, this pattern of breathing, it is actually very well connected with the peaceful state of the mind, with peaceful emotions. So if you develop this kind of habit of breathing, even for 5 to 10 minutes every day, you will see after finishing this 5-10 minutes of practice, your mind is very well focused, very well concentrated, and very calm and relaxed. So this is the very simple technique which I wanted to share with you. And all those people who ask me question about how to use, you know, abdominal breathing while practicing pranayama, so this is your answer. So you can practice this technique to develop your pranayama practice. The second technique today I would like to share with all of you, that is viloma pranayama. Most of you have heard about anuloma viloma pranayama, you know, anuloma viloma pranayama, also nadi shuddhi pranayama. So nadi shuddhi pranayama or nadi shodhana pranayama or anulom vilom pranayam, this is the same technique. Actually, the names are different. Nadi Shuddhi name, Nadi Shodhan name is given in Hatha Yoga. Okay. So it's the same technique. Now we are practicing vilom pranayam. Vilom pranayam, actually, it's a very simple technique, but very effective technique for those people who are suffering with asthma or who have weak lungs. Because there were some questions asked by some people that Brahmari Pranayam, when they practice Brahmari Pranayam or when they practice Nadi Shuddhi Pranayam, which we have done last week, they felt out of breath. So it was not easy for them to, you know, extend their voice for Brahmari for long duration. After 3-4 seconds, they felt tired. Same thing happened with Nadi Shuddhi Pranayam. Some people, they wrote me that after short time, they felt out of breath. And even some people, they, you know, they felt kind of tired after those techniques. And that's why I have decided that I will include this technique in today's practice, that is viloma pranayama. Very simple technique, viloma pranayama. For example, if I ask you that you have to walk 20 meters, for example, if I ask you to walk for 20 meters, right? 20 meters distance. But by holding 20 kilogram of bag or 30 kilogram of bag in your hand. So if I give you a big bag with 30 kilogram, like a lot of stuff inside, and if I ask you, carry the bag, don't put it down, carry the bag, hold it in your hand, okay, walk for 20 meters, and then only put your bag down. Okay. It's not actually that much difficult task. Many of you can do it easily. You can hold the bag, walk for 20 meters and put it down. Okay. But if we observe ourselves, we will be a little bit tired. those people who are weak, it will be difficult for them even to carry and to walk 20 meters. For some of you, you can do it very easily. But if I ask you now, the distance is same, the bag is same, and the person is same. But now if I ask you, time doesn't matter. How much time you are going to spend to walk 20 meters doesn't matter. Okay, so I give you freedom to put the bag down. So if I ask you, okay, carry the bag, 30 kilograms, same bag. After 5 meters, put it down, relax. Again, lift the bag, again walk for 5 meters, again put it down. Again, lift the bag, again walk for 5 meters, put it down. This type of walking will be easier, right? For example, the first experiment, carrying the bag, walking for 20 meters without putting it down, might be a little bit tiring, but the second experiment, carrying the bag after every 5 meters, you are putting it down and then walking a bit easier. So Vilom Pranayam, the concept of Vilom Pranayam is same, because when we ask people to inhale deeply, long and deep inhalation, for many people it's not easy to inhale deeply for long duration, because even if they want to deep inhale for long duration, even if they want to inhale for long duration, it is not easy for them to inhale for long duration, because the capacity of the lungs doesn't allow them, because lungs are not strong enough, lungs are not that much strong to inhale long duration, because their lungs allow them to inhale for very, very short duration. So especially people who are suffering with asthma, it's very difficult for them to use the maximum capacity of the lungs. Sometimes people, because of overweight, if you look at their breathing, it is difficult for them to breathe in. Even if they walk for some time without any luggage in their hand, still they feel out of breath, they feel kind of out of breath and they start breathing a little bit intensively. So this pranayama is very good for such kind of people. Not only for such kind of people, but even for all of us. Today we are going to practice this pranayama. Now in this pranayama, what we are going to do, we are going to inhale through the nose and exhale through the mouth. Again, listen carefully. In this pranayama, in Viloma pranayama, we are going to inhale through the nose and exhale through the mouth. And when you will exhale through the mouth, you need to roll your lips and exhale through the mouth like Amrut Pranayam. If you remember Amrut Pranayam, in Amrut Pranayam, we are breathing out through the mouth. Okay? Here also you are going to breathe out through the mouth by rolling your lips, not tongue. Okay, last time some people they asked me this, like rolling the tongue, but you are actually not rolling the tongue. You are rolling lips only. Rolling tongue is Kaki Mudra. It's another pranayama. In the future we will study, that is Shitali Pranayama. In Shitali Pranayama, you roll your tongue like this. Okay. But today we are not going to roll the tongue. Today we are going to roll the lips only, like you are whistling. Okay. But you don't whistle. Like whistling, you are rolling the tongues. So inhalation should be done through the nose. Exhalation should be done through your mouth by rolling your lips. Okay. Next thing. Now, at the time of inhalation, instead of doing one long inhalation, what you will do? You will take 4 breaths, 4 pauses. So you inhale a little bit, then you pause. Again, you inhale a little bit more, then you take pause. Again, you inhale a little bit more, take pause. And fourth time, you inhale maximum, take pause. And then after 4 breaths of deep inhalation, exhale through your mouth. So how big this roll of the lips should be? How big this roll of the lips should be? For example, if you breathe out on your hand through your mouth, so it should make thin line, not big circle. Okay. If you breathe out through your mouth on your hand, it should make thin line. Okay. Not big circle. Understood? So this is Vilom Pranayam. In Vilom Pranayam, you're inhaling through your nose, exhaling through your mouth by rolling your lips. Okay. Then At the time of inhalation, you inhale with four breaths. One, pause. Two, pause. Three, pause. Four, maximum, pause. And breathe out smoothly. Now, one condition. In this technique, all these breaths should be equal. Okay. For example, if you take four breaks, so every break 25%, 25%, 25%, 25%. Some people, what they do, in the first attempt, in the first break, they inhale deeply and then they don't have air left, you know, capacity left, and then the next three breaks are very short. Okay, so don't do that. Every break should be equal. One, two, three, four maximum, and then breathe out. I'm going to show you a couple of rounds. Just watch. Okay. Look at me. That is Viloma Pranayama. Look at me. So first I'm breathing out completely through the mouth. And then I'm breathing in. One, two, three, four. So this was exhalation. Again, watch, breathing in, one, two, three, maximum four, breathing out through the mouth. So very, very simple pranayam, especially very easy pranayam for old age. You know, sometimes people at the old age, not all of you, don't get offended, but especially some people with the old age, it is difficult, and especially with overweight, it is difficult for them to inhale deeply. So this pranayama is very effective for them. They can inhale with breaths. If it is difficult for them to take four breaths, you can even take three breaths. Okay. Now we are going to practice Viloma Pranayama. Let's practice it together. First couple of rounds, I will be giving you instructions, and then after that, I will ask you to practice by yourself. We will be practicing it for next 3 days. Be seated in any comfortable meditative position. It can be Padmasana, Swastikasana, or you can even sit in Vajrasana, or you can even simply sit on your sofa or on the chair. But as I said, the surface on which you are sitting should be hard surface. So now close your eyes. Keep your hands in Jnana Mudra on your knees. Back straight, neck straight, back straight. Next straight. Breathe smoothly. Please do not control your breath yet. Breathe normally. Just breathe smoothly. Relax your back, neck. Relax your shoulders, arms, chest, abdomen. For next 3 minutes, we are going to practice Viloma Pranayama. For next 3 minutes, we are going to practice Viloma Pranayama. Now get ready. First of all, breathe out completely through your mouth. And we are going to start. Breathe in. One, pause. Two, pause. Three, pause. And maximum four, pause. Now breathe out through your mouth by rolling your lips smoothly. Very good. Very good. Again, breathe in. One, pause. Two, pause. Three, pause. Four, maximum pause. And now breathe out smoothly through your mouth by rolling your lips. I hope you understood this technique. Let's continue for 2 more minutes. Continue by yourself. Eyes closed. Back straight. Neck straight. Please continue the practice. Please continue the practice. Inhalation should be done through the nose with 4 breaths, with 4 pauses. Equal breaths, equal pauses. And exhalation should be done through your mouth by rolling your lips. Breathe deeply with four breaths and breathe out long without any breaths. So for exhalation, you are not doing any breaths. One more minute, one more minute. Last 30 seconds. Last two rounds of Vilom Pranayama. And after completing these two rounds, breathe normally. Eyes are still closed. Breathe normally. If your legs are tired, you can straighten the legs. And now slowly open your eyes. Now, the last pranayama for today, that is Ujjayi pranayama. The last pranayama for today, that is Ujjayi pranayama. One of the very, very beautiful, very simple practice. Ujjayi pranayama is mentioned in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, in those eight pranayama, and which comes in the category pre-meditative pranayama. So Brahmari and Ujjayi, actually both of these pranayama, it helps to develop the state of the mind which will improve our meditation practices. Ujjayi is very beautiful pranayama. It is very useful for those people who are suffering with depression, anxiety, too much stress disorders. Ujjayi pranayama, it is even good for those people who are suffering with insomnia, can't sleep very well. If they practice Ujjayi pranayama before going to sleep for 5 to 10 minutes, they will sleep much better. Ujjayi pranayama, it is even better for those people who are snoring in the night. If they practice Ujjayi before going to sleep, first they have to drink one glass of warm water or warm milk and then practice Ujjayi for 5 minutes. So those people who have problem insomnia, can't sleep very well, or those people who have problem snoring, if they practice Ujjayi before going to sleep, it is very useful. Even Ujjayi pranayama, it is very useful for those people who are suffering with hypertension, high blood pressure. Whenever people have high blood pressure, if they practice Ujjayi pranayama, within 5 to 10 minutes, the blood pressure will come down. Ujjayi pranayama is very beautiful practice which works on the parasympathetic nervous system, which is responsible for rest and recovery. It's a very good pranayama which restores the energy in our body. It's very good pranayama to calm, to relax. In Brahmari pranayama, in the previous pranayama, last week, we have studied how to make sound in Brahmari pranayama. In Ujjayi pranayama also, we are going to make sound. But here, the sound is not strong sound like Brahmari. Here, the sound is frictional sound. Sound is frictional sound. So we human beings, you know, we can make different kinds of sound. Our sound comes from the vocal cord. There is one kind of sound which we use for communication. We can create a sound with, you know, clapping. When two objects, they bang on each other, it creates the sound. when the two objects, you know, when you rub them on each other, it's a frictional sound, you know, different sounds are there. So Ujjayi pranayama, in which you are going to make frictional sound, it's difficult, especially for the online class. It is difficult to show the demonstration of Ujjayi, but I hope still it will be easy for you to understand Ujjayi. I'm going to use my headphone so that it will be easy for you to listen the sound of Ujjayi. Have you heard the cobra? You know, when the cobras or other snakes, they are in a mood to attack, you know, they have this kind of hissing sound. You know, this sound is just to threaten the person or the other animal. If they are in a mood to attack, you know, they make such kind of hissing sound. The same kind of hissing sound is there. Or even when you are cutting the wood, it's soft. So same hissing sound is there. So how to make such kind of sound? And from which part this sound should come? Ujjayi, in Ujjayi pranayam, the sound, hissing sound, the frictional sound should come in the throat. Sometimes it comes in the nose. I'm going to tell you how to check whether the sound is right or wrong. Okay. So sound should come in the throat. So when you are inhaling, when you are exhaling, you need to kind of squeeze the throat slightly. Okay. And because of this small passage, the friction will happen in the throat. When the friction will happen in the throat, you can feel a little bit cool air passing in the throat. Little bit cool air passing in the throat. But if you make the sound through the nose, okay, you will not feel this cool air going here, but you will feel cool air going in the nose. Okay. So this is the most important. I'm going to show you what is correct. I'm going to show you what is wrong. So it will be easy for you to understand and to correct your practice by your own. So how to practice Ujjayi? Now listen, I'm going to use my headphones now. So when you practice Ujjayi, we are going to inhale through the nose and exhalation also should be done through the nose.
Now listen very carefully. First of all, I'm going to show you what is the correct sound and then I'm going to show you what is wrong.
Ujjayi pranayam. In Ujjayi pranayam, we are going to make sound in the throat. It's a hissing sound, frictional sound. At the time of inhalation and exhalation, you need to squeeze the epiglottis, squeeze the throat, and you can feel the friction in your throat or little bit cooling air passing through the throat at the time of inhalation and exhalation. Ujjayi pranayam. Try to avoid making sound through the nose, but practice it through the throat.
Now, I'm going to show you some people when they breathe through the nose, what happens? You know, the sound comes like this. So, you know, when people breathe through the nose, when the sound comes through the nose, they can feel the cool air going through the nose, even the nasal passage, you know, you can feel the contraction in the nasal passage and you don't even feel too much in the throat. But when you do this frictional sound in the throat, you can feel the cool air passing in the throat. Now, if you want to make stronger sound, if you want to make good Ujjayi sound, what you can do, keep your teeth, back teeth together. Okay, press them on each other. And then make the sound. Because if your teeth are separate, the sound will not be that much strong. Okay. But if the teeth are pressed together, the sound will be good. Now, on this online class, it will be difficult for me to observe your practice. So anyway, I'm going to give you some time to practice Ujjayi. Now, how to apply or when to apply this practice? For example, if you are walking or if you are climbing mountains, you know, if you feel that you are getting tired while walking or while climbing mountains or while even cycling or while doing any activities, if you feel that you are getting tired, you know, immediately switch to Ujjayi and you will feel that within 5, 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes, you will feel much, much better. Okay? But have you observed the breathing? Our brain knows very well. Whenever we are tired, our brain automatically switches on Ujjayi by itself, by himself. So whenever we are climbing the mountain, for example, at the bottom of the mountain, like we, when you have still haven't started climbing the mountain or when you are still relaxed, our breathing is smooth. There is no noise of the breath. But as soon as you start doing some intensive activity, you know how people breathe intensively. You know? Automatically friction happens here. So it is actually very good pranayam for relaxation. It is very good pranayam to get rid of the stress. It's very good pranayam to relax the heart. So whatever limited information I have about medical science, I'm just going to share with you. I request all the doctors who are sitting here to kind of help me if I will do any mistakes with this. So whatever I have studied, it says that our heart, and from our heart, we have one artery going towards the brain, that is carotid artery. So in this region, it divides, it goes to the right side of the brain, one go to the left side of the brain, carotid artery, and the junction, it is called as carotid sinus. And actually this junction, it is responsible to control the blood pressure in the brain. So whenever we practice Ujjayi, actually it works on this carotid sinus and that helps to relax, that helps to control the blood pressure. Then the another thing, when you practice Ujjayi pranayam, it gives very good effect on the thyroid and the parathyroid gland. So those people who are suffering with any issues with the thyroid or parathyroid gland, it is very effective practice for them. Even this pranayam is very good for infection. Of course, during infection, this pranayam should not be practiced. Those people who are having already throat infection, during throat infection, it will be even uncomfortable to practice Ujjayi pranayam. Okay. So it's better not to practice. But when you are not having any infection and if you practice Ujjayi pranayam on the regular basis, then you will have less chances to get throat infection. So it's a very good pranayam. Also, Ujjayi pranayam can be used before going to sleep to get deep sleep. You know, sometimes people say that we don't have any issues with the sleep, we sleep better. Like whenever we go to bed, we can sleep better. But when they get up in the morning after 7 hours sleep or after 8 hours sleep or sometimes after 10 hours sleep, after getting up in the morning, they say, oh, you know, I still feel sleepy. I feel still feel tired. I feel like I didn't sleep enough. I want to sleep even more. What it shows the quality of the sleep was not good. The depth of the sleep was not very good, you know. So Ujjayi pranayam, actually, it is very beautiful, very good pranayam to improve the sleeping quality. If you practice Ujjayi pranayam before going to bed, if you practice Ujjayi pranayam before going to sleep, it's better you drink one glass of warm water or warm milk and then practice Ujjayi. It will improve the quality of the sleep. It will improve the depth of the sleep. And after 2, 3, 4 hours of sleep, you will feel still strong, energetic. When I was doing my advanced courses in Yog Vidya Dham in India, I had a lot of activities and I used to come home very late, around 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. And my morning class used to be at 5 o'clock. So I had to leave. I was driving my bicycle those days and I used to leave my home at 4, 4:30 in the morning because it was far distance, 20 kilometers to drive bicycle. So it was very short time. And one of my teacher actually, who was my beginners, like when I was very beginner, he told me to practice Ujjayi before going to sleep. So I used to practice Jyoti Tratak, then Ujjayi, and then I used to sleep. So this kind of schedule lasted for around 2, 3 years. So for 2, 3 years, I was sleeping around 3 hours. And then it was really helping me. So I kind of applied this technique. I experienced this practice by myself. That's why I say that Ujjayi really helped me to improve the quality of the sleep, and not only to improve the quality of the sleep, but even to reduce the sleeping time. And even this habit of sleeping still continues. For the last 20 years, sleeping less time, but sleeping good, it really helps me, especially with the help of Ujjayi. So what I'm doing for my Ujjayi, I don't even sit. I simply lie down on my bed and I switch to Ujjayi Pranayama. Even lying down on the bed, I switch to Ujjayi Pranayama. So you can also try today, before going to sleep, practice Ujjayi Pranayama, either in sitting position or even lying down on your bed, and you will see how you sleep. Tomorrow morning, you will feel more energetic, more relaxed, and you can just give me feedback. How did you sleep after Ujjayi? So last time we have studied Bhramari, and I said during Bhramari, we are making sound for exhalation, because inhalation sound is a little bit difficult. But for Ujjayi, we will be doing inhalation and exhalation with both nostrils. Still, we are not practicing pranayama, because last time, as I said, actual pranayama should be done with bandhas, right? By holding your breath, by practicing all the bandhas. And when you will practice Ujjayi pranayama, complete Ujjayi pranayama with bandhas, by retaining your breath, then inhalation should be done through both nostrils, and exhalation should be done only through left nostril, only at the time of pranayama, when you will hold your breath, when you will retain your breath, you know, at that time inhalation should be done Ujjayi with both nostrils, exhalation should be done through left nostril. But today we are not holding the breath, we are not doing any bandhas, that's why we will be inhaling and exhaling with both nostrils, and the sound should come at the time of inhalation and at the time of exhalation as well. Okay, so now I'm going to give you next 3 minutes for Ujjayi pranayama. So keep your back straight, neck straight, close your eyes, sit in any comfortable meditative position, or sit on the chair or on the sofa. Close your eyes, place your hands in Jnana Mudra or Dhyana Mudra. Place your hands in Jnana Mudra. Now bring your focus on your throat. Bring your focus on your throat. Please don't start Ujjayi yet, till we are breathing normally. When I will give you instructions, then you can start. Focus on your throat. Focus on your throat. Breathe smoothly. Relax your neck. Relax your back. Relax your shoulders, arms. Now keep your teeth together. Keep your teeth together, especially back teeth. High teeth. And now we will start with Ujjayi. First of all, breathe out completely through your nose. And now start Ujjayi. Inhalation, Ujjayi, exhalation. Next 3 minutes. Close your eyes, keep your eyes closed, and keep focusing on your throat. Your eyes closed. Continue the practice. Half minute to go. Continue the practice. Back straight, neck straight. One more minute, 1 more minute to go. Back straight, neck straight. Last 30 seconds. Last 2 rounds of Ujjayi. Last 2 rounds of Ujjayi. And after completing Ujjayi Pranayama, keep your eyes closed. Breathe smoothly. Breathe smoothly. And now slowly open your eyes. Slowly open your eyes. Thank you so much. So actually, these are the techniques which I wanted to share with all of you today. So I hope you have understood whatever we have studied today. So just as a revision, quickly I will revise what we have done today. So again, whenever you want to practice pranayama, how you will start? First of all, chant mantra Om 5 times. Or 11 times or 21 times, how much you feel comfortable. After Om, you can do Shanti Mantra or other mantras or prayers, whatever you feel comfortable with. The next thing, practice warm-up exercises. It can be Surya Namaskar or some other warm-up exercises, even Sukshma Vyayam. Then you must practice Shavasana. It is very much necessary after warm-up exercises to stabilize your breathing rate. After Shavasana, you practice Kapalbhati. If you don't know how to practice Kapalbhati, or if you have forgotten how to practice Kapalbhati, then you watch our second video. 2 weeks back, we had our second session. You will understand how to practice Kapalbhati. After Kapalbhati, if you feel tired, then you can lie down on your back. Or if you are fine, then you can simply continue the practice. After Kapalbhati, give some time for Nadi Shuddhi Pranayam. Nadi Shuddhi should be done every session. So Nadi Shuddhi is just considered as a constant practice, common practice. Give minimum 3 to 5 minutes for Nadi Shuddhi Pranayam. And after Nadi Shuddhi Pranayam, one day you can practice Brahmari Pranayam. Other day you can practice Ujjayi Pranayam. Third day you can practice simply deep breathing with the abdominal movement and the thoracic movement. So you now have 3 techniques with you: Brahmari, Ujjayi, and simply deep breathing. Vilom pranayama, it is very good for those people who have weak lungs. But if you are already strong enough, then no need to even practice Vilom pranayama. You can even practice directly Brahmari and Ujjayi. But sometimes if you feel tired, so instead of Brahmari and Ujjayi, it's better you practice Vilom pranayama. Okay. And then at the end, you can, if necessary, again you can practice Shavasana and then you can complete the session. Okay. So thank you so much. Once again, thank you so much, Purnima ji. Thank you so much, Prashant ji. Thank you so much, the whole Bhanupanthi group, for supporting this activity and for giving me opportunity to talk in front of such a beautiful group. Thank you.